well, this is our week. Fall is coming. It's almost here. So we're going to do fall things, and we're going to head back to the writings of an apostle. His name is Peter. We know much about him from the gospel narratives, about his life and his encounters with Jesus. We know about his boldness. We know about his failures. We're going to head into his second epistle. An epistle is a formal letter. It pours from his heart. So imagine with me for a moment, he is no longer the young, strong fisherman. Clearly, he would be in the category of old man by this time. It's very likely he's in some type of a secret dwelling in Rome. And it is not a safe place. And everyone to whom he writes, they are not in safe places. For they are Christians, they will not deny their faith. So here's Peter. Imagine with me for a moment. This is how Chuck Swindoll pens it. So see him as the gray-haired Simon Peter, and he looks west across the Tiber River toward the distant hill. He squints, he can trace the outline of the arena of Caligula, where Nero had been making sport of Christians, torturing them, burning them, hanging them, crucifying them, even feeding them to wild beasts. So far as the Lord had prevented his capture, but he knew it was only a matter of time, though he wasn't yet sure when, where, or how it would happen. The Lord had revealed to him that he would soon depart this life. At any moment, he would hear the door downstairs burst open, the clank of Roman armor, outbursts of coarse Latin slang, and the drawing of swords. Bound like a dangerous criminal, he would be dragged away for a sham trial and condemned to a torturous sentence that far outweighed his alleged crimes. He closed his eyes and recalled the quiet but somber words of his Lord. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to gird yourself, walk wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone will gird you. They will bind you and bring you where you do not wish to go. So when you're old and you know that the clock is ticking, but your heart still beats really, really hard for what you have been commissioned to do, you're not going to necessarily mess around and play with words, but you're going to get down to business. And that is exactly what Peter does. He speaks as a spiritual father. Now, the Bible views humans as naive at best, but mostly wayward, resistant, and rebellious. So, the Bible instructs all of us who are parents and teachers, mentors, authority figures, to instruct young ones in truth, in the right way, in the way of wisdom. In fact, to fail to do so is dereliction of duty. It is living irresponsibly. Peter understands that. He is a spiritual father, and he speaks to the flock. Now, we're in a day and age that it's all about image, and it's all about method and means. And many times we approach the instruction of our children, even inside the walls of our church, with how do we make it interesting and fun? Now, I'm for that. You're for that, right? I hope the pastor keeps things a little bit interesting this morning. Caffeine only goes so far. If you go into a spiritual trance today and you, that wasn't a very good clap, and you hear me clap my hands, I may be coming after you as you drift off into sleep. But if we're not careful, the means becomes more important than the message. Does that make sense? And Peter doesn't mess around at all with methodology. In fact, he's going to say some things that are just very, very straightforward. And you might want to try to dodge some of the things that he has to say, but he just comes right after us, all right? Now, what Peter understands is this. that it is not the method that is foundational, it is the message. The methods may be a means, but it's only a means if what you get to is important. And Peter says this is important. And what's important is that we learn and grow and that we implement everything that leads us toward a knowledgeable, wise, obedient life devoted in following Jesus. And Peter's going to lay that out so it's very clear that there is a way, the truth, the life, it is Jesus. And as we learned in his first letter, Peter understands the need of this. And so clearly he comes and says, wake up. You got to be alert. You've got to be sober. Can you recall some of that preaching back in springtime? 1 Peter repeatedly uses those strong words. Don't you drift off, but instead stay alert, be sober. Peter would say, it's time to grow up. That might be a good title for today, but we're going to talk about this more. It's time to grow up. This is a grow-up passage that we're going to look at. It's in 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to read the first 11 verses in just a moment. Peter says to us, but especially to his listeners at that time, the journey of faith is going to be full of challenges. There are forces that are aligned to distort truth and reality, to deceive you, to harass you, to harm you, to destroy you. And by the way, that is true today as well. If you don't live with alertness, if we don't follow these grow up and these more kinds of principles, we just move toward the drift. In fact, perhaps the greatest means of spiritual anemia in our generation is the lack of the awareness of the strength of this cultural tide in which we live. And it's not just the tide of the world, but behind all of that, there are spiritual forces that are aligned with the cultural. It's the spiritual forces behind the cultural tide, and in this cultural tide we are immersed. And drift is happening faster than we anticipate. And there's so many things that are being done to undermine the authority of God and what God has said. Now, we must not live in fear. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. A whole lot of Christians want to sit in a corner and be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't let news forces be the driver of your fear. We're not supposed to fan that into flames. But what we're to fan in a flame is the gift of God, the ways of God for our lives. So we must live alert, with alertness and discipline. Well, read along with me, would you? This is New Living Translation. Peter writes, this letter is from Simon Peter. I am a slave and I am an apostle of Jesus Christ. And I am writing to you to share the same precious faith to you who share the same precious faith we have. This faith was given to you because of the justice, the fairness of Jesus Christ, our God and Savior. May God give you more and more grace and peace as you grow in your knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. By His divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know Him, the one who called us to Himself by means of His marvelous glory and excellence. And because of His glory and excellence, He has given us great and precious promises. Now, these are the promises that enable you to share His divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. Now, in view of all this, make every effort to respond to God's promises. Supplement, add your faith with a generous provision of moral excellence, and moral excellence with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with patient endurance, and patient endurance with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love for everyone. Yeah, quite a list, isn't it? Go do this. Easy peasy. Start with faith, add 7 more things. Throw in the oven, 350 degrees, 40 minutes, you got it. Now, the more you grow like this, the more productive and useful you will be in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But those who fail to develop in this way are short-sighted or blind, forgetting what they have been cleansed from their old sins. So, dear brothers, sisters, work hard to prove that you really are among those God has called and chosen. Do these things, and you will never fall away. Then God will give you a grand entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, that's our first segment, and it's the first message as we head back into these letters. We're going to have 8 messages that we'll be looking at here in 2 Peter. Now, there's 4 things that I just want you to note and pay attention to from these 11 verses, and the first one is this. Consider what you've been given. And here's what you've been given. Peter lays it out, and he just says, listen, you have privilege like none others have privilege. God has given you the fullness of his power, and he's given you great and precious promises. All right? Now, there's other things that you can add in, but this is how 2 Peter begins. As Peter writes, and he says, listen, I'm a called servant of God. I'm a bond servant to him. But he's also made me an apostle. And I'm writing to you, and he gives kind of a traditional greeting, grace and peace. But it's loaded with him reminding them, don't ever forget when times get tough and when life hurts, don't you ever forget all of these benefits that God has given to you. It's kind of like Psalm 103, and forget not all his benefits. In fact, Peter begins with this rich recollection of everything that's been given to us. It's not been earned by us. It is free gift. So, let's head back through those opening verses. We've been given a faith, okay? And it's because Jesus is just. The justice of God has been satisfied, but there's fairness. He's not a respecter of persons. He's saying not only to the Jews, but also the door's been opened to the Gentiles. We all have this same faith. We're on the same team, and it's because of Jesus' kindness and goodness toward us. He's our God and Savior. And then even in this simple greeting, he just says, I just want you to have more and more. May God give you more and more. This part of my prayer for you, and I'm going to greet you, yes, with grace and peace, but may this abound to you. May there be more and more, but it's been given to you, and may God give you more. And I want you to grow in the knowledge of God. This has been given to you. God has come and revealed himself to you. What a privilege is this? Because in our own natural understanding, it's darkened when we can't see him. We would look on Jesus but never anticipate that this is the Son of God. And yet in these last days, God has made it clear to us. And like his buddy John says, we have beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He's been made known to us. And oh, by the way, it is because of his work and the outpouring of his Holy Spirit, this divine power of God has been made available to every single one of us. And then I've got this highlighted here because this kind of is the very core of what he's saying is, I need you to get it, how good God has been to you, how kind and what he's done for you. This is the privilege, this is the power, these are the promises God has given you. God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. I want to just challenge you to go ahead and just grab that one and I don't know, write it down, put it on your message note, stick it somewhere that when you feel the pull of world and you just feel everything that's antithetical to these 7 additives that God has for your life, I want you to just say it out loud and just say, you know what? I just need to quit my complaining and quit my worrying. God's given me everything that I need in what pertains to living a godly life. He set me up for success. That's what God has done for me. So all of this has been coming to know him, and then, oh yeah, he's called us. This is the new way of life, and it's with marvelous glory and its excellence that he's called us. And he has given us great and precious promises. And all this has to do so we can believe him and trust him, but we get engaged anyway. And as a result, he's given us this open door to share in a divine nature that is beyond us. And we get to escape from all of the corrosion and corruption that comes from the world's way of life. Now, did you get that? Peter's just saying, you may go through tough times, but don't head into a pity party. God has been good to us, and this is the big point. God has set you up for a life of rich meaning and profound impact. That's what Peter's saying. Yeah, we may face the Colosseum. We will face suffering. But in all of this, don't ever forget, God has absolutely set us up. So as a result, let's give him thanks and let's constantly remember this is what God has done. It is not by our accomplishments. It is not by our righteousness. It's not by our goodness. It's because of the mercy and the kindness of God. He's a good God. Is there an amen to that one? He's a good God. All right? And then when I follow him, I get to participate in his works. It gives meaning to my life, but also there's this opportunity for profound impact. The life of the Christian that lives the life of Christ-likeness, of just choosing love over bitterness, choosing righteousness over evil, all those kind of stuff. Anyway, profound impact. There's this deep preservative by those who heed the scriptures and the word of God and follow after him. And I live within the boundaries. Never forget the profound impact. Your life daily is impacted by individuals who understand just this. Anyway, they don't even have to fully understand it. But when they live within the boundaries of God's word and God's blessing, but it's to a different level for those who follow Jesus and want to live like that. Profound impact. No, so then the question becomes, so what do you do with that? If God has set you up for success, it's not just a little thing that a nice little conversation piece that you sit on the coffee table and when company come over, you just kind of look at it and say, oh, yeah. No, but instead what we do is you get busy. And this is what Peter calls for. He calls for us to get busy with this life that we've been set up for a life of rich meaning, profound impact, so let's get busy with it. Okay, let's review these. In view of this, because of this, paying attention to all of this, so make every effort. Make every effort. This is talking about striving. If you've ever heard David Goggins, have you ever heard David Goggins? You ever heard of him? He's like this crazy marine endurance athlete kind of thing that he cusses like a sailor. I wouldn't... Don't read his biography for devotions with your children at night. You'll end up. But his life is amazing because what he did was he like dropped 100 pounds, but he literally went after this sense of what can the human body endure, and what does it mean for me to make every effort. And what he discovered and what he speaks all the time, he just says, listen, we wimp out way too much. There's a place that you think you've given your all and you can press through that. There's more that you can give. And by the way, he's been through that with his body. But I think that much of this is what Peter is saying. So because God's been good to you, I need you to really go after this Christian thing like an endurance sport. Because that's what it is. It is a race to the end of the age that God has for us. So in view of this, make every effort to respond to God's promises. Supplement your faith with generous provision of moral excellence with knowledge, knowledge with self-control with patient endurance with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love for everyone. Peter makes it clear, I want you growing up. I want you participating. I'm praying for you to grow in this knowledge of God and his son, Jesus. Let's go after this thing. So let's just head through it. He talks about moral excellence, the Greek word arete. It implies moral fortitude, courage, the ability based on internal motivators to do what's right and to stand alone if necessary. The emphasis is on an inner disposition of moral soundness from which our words and our behaviors flow. Peter's saying, I want you to go to the moral excellence that the Spirit of God will forge on the inside. If you take it seriously, He'll put something inside of you that is an excellence that causes you to stand up and be different. Fortitude, courage, because it's an internal thing that comes from you. In addition to that, gnosis, knowledge. This is practical knowledge that's learned by keen observation and experience. It's the word that Peter used in encouraging husbands. Pay attention, be attentive to your wives. The idea is know her, observe her, be attentive toward her. It's that kind of knowledge. The Apostle Paul uses the word to speak of knowing Jesus in Philippians 3:8. In other words, personally, meaningfully, this intimate connection that we would have with God. So it's not just a head knowledge, it's an issue of heart knowledge deep inside of us. Also, add this one in as well, self-control. We must never allow anything to control us but our Lord. So the idea is not money, not sex, not power, not food, not drink, not drugs, not habits, not work, not entertainment, not personal goals. But self-control means maintaining a balanced life even when the world encourages indulgence. It means saying no toward things that will just distract us from the focus that God has for our life, where we end up wasting our lives. No, live with self-control. And then he speaks of patient endurance, hypomone. Believers must keep on the narrow path even when confronted with distractions and detours. Didn't God speak to us very clearly? He just said, you're distracted. And in your distraction, you're not listening to me. Okay? So we need this patient endurance that even when distractions and detours of the path come, instead we stay steady on the path. When everything around you tries to pull you off or push you off, it's no, I'm staying steady on the path. So the idea is remain steadfast, stable, clear-headed in the midst of distress or disaster. It's not going to get you a lot of fans on TikTok, this kind of thing, isn't it? But I will tell you this, it will make a profound impact on your life if it's just like, over a period of time, just stay steady in the faithful plodding. That's what Peter is saying. It requires a firm footing, foundation of faith, a clear focus on the pursuit of hope, and an unparalleled patience. Stick with it. Don't quit. This is how it happens. Andy McMonagall, I am told, and I've heard the rumor, the reason he's a guitarist today is because when he got in trouble and was sent to his room, he couldn't do anything except for one thing. Well, if you want to play your guitar, you can play your guitar. Great motivation for when you get in trouble to stick with it, because I'm bored with anything else and everything else has been just tucked in. Okay, I've just been removed from my life. But I will tell you this, kind of focus is really helpful for us in this growing up in our spiritual faith. Stick with it. It's amazing how strong you'll get. Godliness. The idea is authentic piety. It's real. It runs in two directions. First, it refers to one who has the right perspective and attitude towards God. So they live a life showing proper reverence and worship that's due Almighty God. They just love to be with Him, and there's a sense of when you're with them, you kind of feel like sometimes I'm in the presence of God because they're walking with God, and I feel that. But there's this second direction, and it reflects itself on the right view toward others. It's having a genuine servant's heart toward people, giving others their proper honor and respect, godliness. And then the final two, brotherly kindness. You know, it's the word Philadelphia. It's who we are. It's what we do. Brotherly kindness. But the idea is treating others as if they were members of your family. And I hope you love your family. It may drive you nuts at times, but you know, they're your family. We love one another. It includes living in such close relationship with others that we bear one another's burdens and feel each other's joys and pains. So we make room then for other people's opinions. It means we'll shut our mouths at times. And we will listen to individuals. All right? We hear their feelings, their ideas, their suggestions. Brotherly love is the key to living in true and harmonious community. We got to do that as church. Okay? But then the final thing is agape love. You see, all of this ladder of virtues leads to love. It is seeking the highest good for others. It's putting their needs above yourself. It's denying yourself all for the, yes, love of God, but love for other people. It is unconditional devotion. This is the love that God demonstrated to us when he sent Jesus to rescue us. It is the highest Christian virtue. Whew, what a list, right? Go home. Go work on this today. I don't know if that list looks insurmountable to you, like Mount Everest. How do you get to the top of that thing? My word. But just remember this, accompanied by God's promises and his presence through the Holy Spirit, we can take Peter's instructions seriously, and we can begin to apply diligence, having a steady confidence that God will work in us and with us to grow more like Jesus. This is not a losing cause. This is the work of the Spirit of God, but we do participate in it by opening up the door and staying in step. Now, ultimately, this growth leads to usefulness and freedom from short-sighted, wasted living. When we grow like this, it keeps us from becoming ineffective and heading back into slavery to old ways of sin. It's Johann Goethe. I love this quote. Where's the quote? Oh, let me give you the quote and then we'll head and read these verses. A useless life is only an early death. That'll make you think. Great poet and author. I think he wrote the book Faust. Catch these verses. The more you grow like this, in these virtues, adding to your faith, these powerful things in your life, the more productive and useful you will be in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But those who fail to develop in this way are short-sighted or blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their old sins. Now, we don't engage in spiritual disciplines to earn our salvation. That's already ours by grace through faith plus nothing. It is only the finished work of Jesus. But guess what? We constantly make choices and decisions to participate in everything that God has done. And Peter promises we will be useful and productive in our Christian lives if these virtues are, yes, present, but also increasing in our lives through diligence. So we just don't have the responsibility to have these virtues, but to see these virtues that would be growing and for us to put our very best effort to constantly moving toward growth. Oh, the useless life. It is the story of life around us, right? Bored students, burned out CEOs, bone-weary mothers. They're everywhere. They're our neighbors. They're the people we rub elbows with every day. They are searching for meaning but slip into feelings of usefulness and disillusionment. Now, this happens to unbelievers who have embraced empty philosophies of the world system, but it can also happen to believers who have lost track of their diligence in pursuing God's meaning and purpose for their lives. That may be your story today. My life's gone into neutral. I'm here because I know it's the right thing to do, it's the good thing to do, but I'm not necessarily growing real well with every effort to add these virtues into my life. Does anybody in the room want to look back over the years when you're done and have regrets, and you conclude that you lived a useless and unproductive life, and what are they going to say about you then? Oh, they'll talk about you, guaranteed. But my cry is that God would give us the kind of lives that when we finish up, the kinds of things that they will say about us will have to do with the way that we live for Christ. Now, the fourth thing I wanted you to understand is Peter is saying, spiritual disciplines are the evidence of life with Christ and the hope of a glorious eternity. This isn't too much to ask, is it? Peter's exhortation to this growing faith, this process of spiritual maturity, is an urgent and passionate appeal to live out our calling to demonstrate the reality of our salvation to others. Dear brothers, sisters, work hard to prove that you really are among those God has called and chosen. Do these things, and you will never fall away. Then God will give you a grand entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, the entire context shows that Peter already regarded his readers as brothers and sisters who had been called and provided with everything necessary for godly living. So, he's saying, live this thing out subjectively through your spiritual growth. The result of this diligence to grow is stability, usefulness, and fruitfulness. With these things comes eternal reward upon Christ's return. And there is a grand entrance that awaits us. So, make it glorious by your steady faithfulness in your life. Now catch what the writer of Hebrews says. Chapter 6, verses 10 through 12. For God is not unjust. He will not forget how hard you have worked for Him and how you have shown your love to Him by caring for other believers as you still do. Our great desire is that you will keep on loving others as long as life lasts in order to make certain that what you hope for will come true, and then you will not become spiritually dull and indifferent. Instead, you will follow the example of those who are going to inherit God's promises because of their faith and endurance. In real simple words, Peter is challenging his readers, and he's saying, listen, if this is what God's done for you, then why don't you just prove it? Why don't you live it out as constant proof? This is who God is. This is what God has done. This is what He's done for me. This is what He's doing in me. This is what He's building in me. Prove it. Apart from that, we're little more than, I don't know, religious people that may have a confession, but it's not real. It smacks of the pretend that all of us hate so much. Now, we're all unique in these virtues. We have various strengths and weaknesses, depending on our backgrounds, temperaments, and experiences. But it's so important that every single one of us today take inventory within our lives. Do these things, you will never fall away. A lot of people hear this, and then they want to just kind of escape into the argument, well, is it possible to fall away? Is it not possible to fall away? Love of God never fails us. Yes, that's true. But why would you even want to debate that back and forth? Why would you even want to talk about if that's possible or not? Are you thinking about it? The glorious thing that God has done for us when He's brought us into the family is such a marvelous thing. Why would you ever turn your back on that? But I do believe that you have the will. God doesn't then somehow, when you come to Christ, I'm going to obliterate their will and take it away from them. No, you have want-tos inside of you, and you can do what you want to do. God will let you do it. And if you want to totally forsake Him, you totally forsake Him. Some do. Their stories are in the Bible, and we can head to them. But they serve as a warning for us. Don't go that direction. You don't want to fall away from things. You don't want to go your own path, but instead engage in spiritual growth. Now, I want to just tell you this. This life of engaging and proving it and just growing in God, it really begins in one place. You know where it is? Well, it's in the heart, but it gets into you coming before God and say, and talk to God, and pray to God, and talk to Him about these things. How are you going to grow in those things unless you have a coach that takes you through the growth process? And you need to walk with Him and talk with Him every single day. So I need you to take some spiritual steroids and apply it to your prayer life. And if you're anemic in the prayer closet, it's time for that to stop. And it's time for you to have an ongoing conversation with God all the way through life. Because when you talk to God, it's giving permission, it's forging relationship where He can pour all this stuff back into you as you pursue it. In your prayer, give thanks to Him for all that He has provided for you, everything that you have need of for this life of godliness, it is yours. And then I need you to ask Him to search you and show you reality. And if there's any part of your walk with God that really is just pretend, get brutal, say, God, I just need you to search me and show me. If it's merely pretend, I want you to really take me and change me, God. Ask Him to make His power evident in your life. He has promised to do that. When we ask, seek, knock, God shows up. And He isn't resistant toward pouring out His Spirit into our lives. So, if this is the open door for us, let's get busy. Let's participate. Now, you got to say no to some things. There's some things you have to shut down and turn off in life. Why? Because there's a sweeter voice. It's the voice of heaven. Teach you, lead you, guide you. He'll give you the grace to be merciful rather than being mean. He'll give you the ability to stick with it instead of being a quitter all the time. There's all kinds of things that He has. So get busy with that. Take the specific steps to put away behavior, including the thoughts and words that do not build from faith to love. And instead embrace this way of life that Jesus has for us. That moves our faith and develops it where it just looks a whole lot more like Jesus. Musicians are coming back. Now I know this effort can be challenging. But God doesn't, evidently he's convinced we're up to this. Why else would He lay these words out from Peter? I know you can do this. Everything's been provided for you. And then remember this. Peter especially closes and says, when you follow this example, you're going to inherit God's promises because of faith and endurance. And there's a glorious entrance into the kingdom. What it's really saying is you can rest assured that everything invested into this life is well worth it. It is safe and secure for all of eternity. This is our hope. This is our full assurance. Oh Lord, we come to You today and we thank You for Your word. Now God, as we hear it, help us, Lord. Show us how to put it into practice. Help us to get it involved in our life groups and love and spiritual growth with one another for God, for Your honor and for Your glory. Help us to be a church, God, that's just full of maturity and growth. Not in a high-mindedness, a haughtiness that can't stoop, bend down, or God, just be with real people. But God, help us to live lives that are so strong and forged with this power of the Spirit, the divine nature that you have. Help us be so engaged with that kind of relationship and walking in your Spirit, God, that our church just has greater impact day by day, by day by day. Our lives have greater impact, God, moment by moment as we follow after you. We pray, God, that Life Christian Fellowship will always be a church that is devoted to making every effort to adding the more that you have for us into our lives. Growing faith, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Stand with me, would you? I just think it's really appropriate right now. If you'd like prayer for this kind of spiritual growth, fresh new growth in your life, I'd love for you to just step on forward right now, and somebody's going to meet you and pray with you here today. We're going to ask that God forge inside of you more want to, more a sense of power and passion than you've ever had before for your spiritual thriving in your life with Jesus. Just step on down. We're going to finish the song out. And then we're not going to close with a amen or anything like that. But we're going to close with praying for individuals that come on down. And I want you to go have a blessed life, blessed day, blessed week in the Lord. God bless you.
No one lies. Starts changing. Oh, I'm gonna worship till I mean every word. 'Cause the way I feel and the fear I'm facing doesn't change.